Welcome to Africa's number one sports podcast show, the Africa Sports Report. From the Straits to Gibraltar, to the Cape of Good Hope, and from the Horn of Africa to the point of no return in Senegal, we bring you the critical issues like no other. Insightful, inspiring, and engaging. We engage stockholders and world-class athletes like no other. And now, your host, Leslie Karoma.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the Africa Sports Report podcast, and thank you for joining us. Today I'll be talking to Prince Narkortu Teye, the founder of the African Sports Center for Data Research and Technology. Today is Africa Day. Prince Narkortu Teye is one of these key stakeholders in the sports business across Africa, just like myself and a good number of other people out there. Prince has been able to create his company and also has created an impact with the AfroSports Summit, which he'll be hosting in Accra, Ghana on the 2nd and 3rd of August this year. Happy Africa Day to everyone out there, to all Africans on the continent and globally. It is incumbent upon all of us to step forward, to do what we can, to create an impact and to create positive change. And that's what Prince is doing with the Africa Sports Center for Data Research and technology, and that's what myself I'm doing with this podcast and my companies that I've created. And I look up to all of you all out there who are celebrating Africa today, you celebrating your Africanness, to also step up in your own realm, in your own way, to see how much of a positive impact you can create in your local community, in your country, and for the African continent overall, and globally for humanity. Folks, I've had a very interesting conversation with Prince, and I'll be bringing that conversation with you shortly after this music break. So don't go nowhere. Stay tuned, and I'll be right back.
Short. For your sake, I go church. Yeah. We go drive around you for my Porsche. Baby, pana, they say you like you all. I get you all. Baby, pana, anywhere that you go, I go follow you to go. Baby, pana, they say you like cassava. I get you big cassava. Hey, baby, pana, my love for you. Never die, you never die. If I ever, oh baby, if I ever. Baby, you too sweet, if I ever. My baby dance to do the lagbaja. Make a take you to Pabalada. If I ever, oh baby, if I ever. Baby, you too sweet, if I ever. My baby dance to do the lagbaja.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. This is your host, Leslie Karoma, with the Africa Sports Report podcast. And welcome to another edition of the Africa Sports Report podcast. Today I'll bring you a guest who's also a heavyweight in the sports space in Africa and is doing great things. His name is Prince Narkortu Teye. You are the founder of the Africa AfroSports Summit, which you've held the first edition for, and you're looking to have the next edition sometime later on this year. Yeah, so basically what I want is for the audience to get acquainted with you as someone who's playing a significant role in the sports space in Africa. So could you give us a little background to who you are, Prince, as an entrepreneur, as a sports thought leader, and so much more?
I'm Prince Narkortu Teye, and I really must commend you for getting my name's really right, because people really struggle to mention my name.
Okay.
Well, on the first try, so yeah. I'm a journalist, a researcher, and entrepreneur. Up until last year, June, that's from 2015, I was working for gold.com or Gold Africa. reporting news for them from Ghana and Africa. In terms of entrepreneurship, like you mentioned, I'm the founder and CEO of the African Sports Center for Data Research and Technology. We're organizers of the AfroSports Summit, which we'll be talking about shortly. Generally, I see myself as a researcher. I have a sports health and science degree, my master's, I beg your pardon, from the Brunel University in London.
Okay.
Essentially, where the whole idea was to basically expand my research knowledge and expertise to be able to work properly, especially to support the work of the African Sports Center, where basically data and research are the kind of things we do. So in terms of introduction, just a journalist, or former journalist, if you wish to put it that way, though I still see myself as a journalist, a researcher professionally, with my master's from Brunel University, London, entrepreneur, brain behind African Sports Center for Data Research and Technology, and AfroSports Summit.
Wonderful.
And yeah, I've been in London, in the UK.
Okay.
But I must add, originally Ghanaian, I've lived in Ghana all my life. So that's
okay. Wonderful. 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 Thank you for that expanded edition of your, who you are, introducing yourself to the audience. And folks, I'm pleased to talk to Prince this morning. It's morning my time. I believe it's afternoon where he's in London currently. And as you said, you rightly said, you have a journalistic background. We all come from that background. And I believe that's what's giving us the impetus to go out there and try to see. Because we get insight into the problems. We see what the issues are. So for us, it's about, okay, well, how do we make a difference? How do we change this narrative and turn it into something positive instead of all the negativity we hear all the time, right?
Yeah, absolutely. The very best way to identify problems is to get close to the source of the problem. And as journalists, as writers, as reporters, being so close to the game really gives you that opportunity to really engage with the various sporting disciplines or whatever it is you do at very close quarters, engage with the stakeholders in very close circles, engage with the sports closely, so you get to see firsthand what are the issues and challenges facing the sport, but also quite significantly, because not everything is doom and gloom, also the opportunities available therein. So yeah, I think that being a journalist for most of us has really served us well, because it gave us that opportunity to learn more, also to connect, to make contact with the relevant institutions, stakeholders, officials, that kind of thing. And hopefully, or in the end, when we get to that point where we move on from just being journalists to being entrepreneurs, it serves us well in giving us that good background information about the challenges that we seek to solve in terms of the various brands and companies that we, or organizations that we set up. So that is definitely a very useful thing to have, especially in Africa.
Yeah, that's truly so. And I have to commend you for taking the onus on yourself, just like myself, I did some years back, having been in the space for that long, and for taking the onus on yourself to say, okay, well, you know what, it's not just about talking about the problems, it's about how do we find solutions. So that gave rise to you putting together and finding your company, African Sports Center, right? So now, could you give an insight into what you guys do at the African Sports Center for the Data Research and Technology?
Right. So before I even get into that, let me just give you a very brief background into how I even got to the African Sports Center,
mm-hmm.
Which quite relates well to the first question about being in the media space and engaging with the sports directly. So before I started working for the African Sports Center, I was working for the WHO Collaborating Center for Training and Advocacy in Pharmacovigilance. Just maybe a bit of extra information that for my first degree, which I did in Ghana, it was biological science.
Okay.
So after my first degree, I worked for the WHO Collaborating Center for Training and Advocacy in Pharmacovigilance. which works hand in hand with the Ghana FDA and also obviously the WHO headquarters, essentially monitoring side effects of drugs in Ghana and Africa generally. Whilst there, all this while, I was working as a journalist for Gold.com on the side as a part-time job. So whilst at the WHO Center, obviously, in terms of the Food and Drugs Authority in Ghana and most of the decisions that they do, it was just about pharmacovigilance, which essentially is monitoring the side effects of drugs. And to be able to monitor side effects of drugs, essentially, have to collect data to be able to make that decision about the safety of these drugs in the market. So whilst I was working in this space, that was why I got introduced to data, to research, to technology, a lot more in a very intimate way. And obviously, I was working as a journalist. So as a journalist, one of the issues you would typically struggle with in Africa is information or data about information. We basically don't have solid repositories or storages or hubs where we can have verified information or solid data units where we know that we are collecting data on very important things that we need to not just for the decision makers to make informed decisions, but even for the reporters in terms of just common statistics about various parameters that we are looking for in your daily reporting or reporting as a journalist, it becomes a problem. So at that point, working at the WHO organization, that was where I was like, okay, we are making solid use of data and research in the health or science background where I was working for. And as a journalist, I could really see the firsthand deficit in terms of data, in terms of my daily reporting for Gold.com. So why don't you have such a similar unit in Ghana or in Africa where we essentially would be collecting data, would be engaging in research? And hopefully that helps to, you know, bridge that gap that I felt at the time. So that was where the whole idea of the African Sport Center came from. Essentially, simply borrowing or taking from data and research from my WHO center and just packaging everything, doing some additions and subtractions, you know, and then bringing it into sports. And that was where the idea of the African Sport Center for Data Research and Technology came about. So essentially, it's simply an organization focused or committed to championing the use of scientific and technical methodologies and innovations for sports development. And largely, we base a lot of the things, or almost all the things we do, on data, research, and technology, because we think that research, data, and technology becomes the bedrock of almost every single thing you do, whether in media, whether in transfers, whether in the boardrooms. Every single thing now is based on solid decisions, solid research, solid data. And so we are simply encouraging the use of data and research to back the various things that we do in sports from all these quarters. And that is what African Sports Center for Data Research and Technology essentially seeks to do. And in doing this, we have had to engage with the stakeholders, which also working as a journalist sort of helped, because then I had a very strong network of contacts in sports already. So now having to do this work and having to basically reach out to these other stakeholders, having to push this agenda first and foremost of data research and technology, which is not something that is really strong in Africa, it really has been useful for me, having that network from journalism. And yeah, that is what essentially we are doing at African Sports Center for Data and Research and Technology. First and foremost, championing, pushing the news or the agenda out there, encouraging more use of data, research, and technology, more use of science for our daily activities in sports. And then from just being advocates, also collecting the data, research, and technology, and putting out reports or research work that essentially foster more quality decision-making in the sports space in Africa.
That's awesome. That's truly an awesome initiative, and as you said, it's very much needed. Some of us operated strictly off of what we were doing at African Sport Monthly is, what we collected basically had articles and stuff, and then we were just we didn't collate as you're trying to do now with the African Sports Center. for research in data research in technology, which is a more constructive, structured approach. Awesome. Really kudos to you, and thank you for that. And it's really very much needed. Every one of us should be benefiting from that efforts right there that you're putting together, because it's really important, you know, very important in this business. We're trying to shape the African sports industry. And I say we're trying to, because we're all in this effort together. And the sports space in Africa as an industry is in its infancy. Most African nations are about 50, 60, 70 years old, you know, not even 70 yet. And so, in my view, we cannot compare ourselves to nations which are 300, 400, 500, 600 years old. They're only recently coming into their own in terms of the sports space. Because let's be realistic, the sports space actually came of age in terms of an industry in the 80s and 90s. And when it actually started to be transformed into something that we consider an industry today. So for us in Africa, I believe we've heard a lot of complaints that we're lagging behind and so on and so forth. But in my view, I think we're right where we need to be, because we don't have the right personnel. We don't have the right structures like you putting together the research center that you have, and me working in media, and of course with content development at Africa Sports Ventures Group. You know, all of those avenues, things that need to be in place, in position, for us to actually make manifest what we consider a sports industry. So in my view, I think we're all pioneers, we're trailblazers, we're all doing what's necessary to shape up what will be a robust industry in Africa in the future. So kudos to you for what you're doing, and something in the right direction. So now, in terms of engaging stakeholders and putting the ideas together, you know, putting things together to spur growth, to spur development, you came up with the AfroSports Summit, whose first edition you had last year, right? 2022, right? So this is 2023. Okay, so the AfroSports Summit is really another fresh, great, wonderful idea as well. Pushing the narrative, in other words. We're pushing the narrative towards where it needs to be. So give the audience an insight, folks out there who don't know about the AfroSports Summit, who are hearing about it for the first time. The first one that happened, obviously, most of us who were in the sports space knew about it. We saw it. We saw what you guys did. Amazing job, planning and all that stuff. It was really well put together. And you're going for the second edition. Got a great lineup of speakers already. So tell the audience about the AfroSports Summit and the role that this summit is going to be playing going forward in the sports space in Africa.
Right. The AfroSports Summit has been something that is really part of our advocacy thought chain process. A bit of background also into how we arrived at AfroSports Summit, which would even make you appreciate AfroSports Summit even more. So like I said, African Sports Center for Data Research and Technology, essentially now, a lot of what we are doing is simply one, advocacy, and then also two, basically doing the data collection ourselves and putting our report. So we have put our works on the digital space in terms of sports, in terms of the props and the clubs, how they are doing on social media, and these other parameters or dynamics, which is really essential for fan engagement and sponsorships and partnerships and all these other things. But beyond that as well, we have done some market research, essentially mostly on the Ghana Premier League. So in 2018, we came up with the Ghana Premier League report, which was a market research work focusing on consumer behavior in relation to revenue opportunities for the Ghana Premier League. The Ghana Premier League at the moment is not doing as well as it used to do back then. The stadia are not filled as we would want the stadia to be filled. In terms of even following on TV, on radio, the level of interest generally, I would say, has dropped. So we took it upon ourselves, essentially dig into why we have such consumer behavior, and even in that, what are the revenue opportunities but also what are the challenges that need to be solved to basically boost the revenue opportunities that lie in there. So we had the first edition, published the first report in 2018, and then the second report in 2019. But as typical of every research or scientific organization, monitoring and evaluation is really key in terms of measuring the impact of whatever you do. So before we put out the second edition of the report in 2019, we went back to stakeholders, the end users of the product, to really find out how useful they found the first report that we put out. And one of the key things, which I feel like this is a major conversation that needs to be put out there a lot more, has to do with the consumption of our research by the end users, by the industry players. Essentially, most of them said they struggled with the consumption because maybe it was a bit too technical for them. Even though from our point of view, we already have that in mind and we try to make the report as practicable and with very user-friendly language, so to speak, for the consumers to be able to really get it. A lot of them said, look, your report looked too technical for us. So they were really struggling with the consumption. Other people also were struggling to get how the report or the research plays out practically or its applied manner in the real world case or in the real world industry in sports. So based off these feedback that we picked from our monitoring and evaluation of the first report that we did ahead of the second edition, we came up with the idea that instead of simply publishing the reports on our website and going to distribute it to the major stakeholders, the clubs, the Ghana Football Association, the Ghana Olympic Committee, even to the general public, and hoping that they read, they consume, and take very useful things from them, why don't we now organize a webinar so that we can bring various key stakeholders onto that webinar, and obviously the general public, and then we get to describe the applied importance of that research, and so that people are able to more connect with the research and understand why it is important. And also in terms of some people or some key players maybe feeling that they were struggling with the language or it was a bit too technical for them, maybe it helps to break things down a bit for them. So we had the very first webinar where we had various people around. I think we had on one of these webinars, we've had Senzo Mbatha, who I think the deputy head of tournament for the 2010 World Cup, currently there. I think the chief executive of the Botswana Football League. We've had Akofa Bansen, who is the general manager of Star Times Ghana. We've had Zarina Bado, who is the general manager of Go Africa. And all these other great people. We had Asante Kotoko CEO, Nana Jawamonsa, on one of them. All these people essentially coming on this webinar to really discuss how this report applies to their daily work. And so that people are able to really understand things more in the applied manner. And we're quite surprised with the level of turnout because we had loads of people, even people from outside Ghana. Mind you, the case study in this case was the Ghana Premier League. So we're quite surprised to see people from the Philippines, people from Sweden, obviously people from a lot of people from around Africa on that, webinar. And for that, that was a level of encouragement for us to know that, look, we have to do these levels of engagement more with these stakeholders. So we did that, and then we held a second webinar again, and we could just see growing interest in the webinars on and on and on. So we were like, okay, instead of just continuing to have these webinars, which were clearly useful judging by the level of interest and the level of contribution on these webinars, why don't we actually move everything to in-person and have everything where we bring all these people to one central location? And then we get to benefit from the added benefits of an in-person meeting where it's not just about the discussions, but also get to even facilitate the level of connections and networking that basically comes with some of these events, get to have exhibitions, get to have cocktail galas to basically promote the connections and networking, and also essentially facilitate better discussions, which will be stronger in person. And so that was how we from just simply putting out the report to going one level further to having webinars to discuss the report. And from there, also now moving to have an in-person event. So last year, we held the very first edition of the AfroSports Summit, which is what we called it, essentially to bring together the major stakeholders in Africa and beyond to a special event for learning and sharing ideas, also for advancing discussions, and also networking in a unique intersection of science and business. And this final part is really quite important or quite fascinating for us, obviously because we see a lot of events or sports events being done purely in the sciences. And then we also see a lot of sports business events. But we felt that looking around, we didn't have many of such events where we would have a clear intersection of these two. But basically, the sciences essentially are fueling the business side, and the business side are also fueling the sciences. So we felt that these were two umbrellas that needed to be combined together in terms of the event, so that people from the business side of the sports and people from the science side of sports all find this event very useful, and we don't, you know, have that dichotomy of the sciences, the people in the sciences having their own sports conferences, and the people in the business world having their own conferences. And so we had that idea to bring everything together. And so we had a very first edition where we, the target audience typically for this event are the clubs, the leagues, the federations, the athletes, the coaches, businesses, academia, media, distinguished personalities, and these sort of people. And essentially, we are looking at anybody of importance or value of relevance, so to speak, in the sports value chain. And so, again, we're not just looking at really people purely or directly within sports, but people within the sports value chain, for instance. And I feel like this is also a part of the conversation that a lot of people do not really focus so much on. You look at, well, I don't want to mention any particular company, but there are loads of companies who are not directly in the sports industry, but who are within the sports value chain, key contributors. And when we are having these sort of sports conferences, we seem mostly to overlook these people. But in terms of sponsorship, these people who are not sporting companies or sporting brands really contribute significantly to the sporting industry. So then again, in terms of the audience or the target audience, essentially we have tried to expand it to include people of relevance within the sports industry. And also another key thing that we picked coming into this event was that, well, people told us that, or I mean, in terms of research work that we did, some of the findings that we had were that, okay, we have some other events, but some of them are too high level. And so people in the medium space level in Africa don't find these other high level events quite useful to them, or they don't even find the chance to be able to attend these sort of events. And so we have looked at all these other things to be able to come up with an event that essentially has a space for people from the highest level, also to the mid-level, and even students, you know, people who are up-and-coming people who would have a lot to learn being at this event. And so that is essentially the concept of the AfroSports Summit, which essentially would have, we have a congress, we have the exhibition or the expo, we have the industry talks, we have the cocktail gala on the first night of the event, and many more exciting features of the AfroSports Summit.
Wonderful, wonderful. That's a you know, very, very refreshing to see the kind of connecting the dots, and at the same time making it so much more relevant for folks to understand exactly what they're in there for and what this is all about, you know, at the end of the day. Because again, like I say, it's about, well, what I'll call the lowest common denominator, in a sense, when you're trying to understand something, you got to go to the to a point where it becomes seamless to understand, to get the message. And I think you guys have put together a great formula there with that. And kudos to you guys on that. And, you know, me and you have talked before about your initiative and what you guys are doing, and highly commend it. And obviously, you extended an invitation for me to be at the next edition coming up, and I've accepted. God willing, I'll be there. And it's important for the growth of the space. As you know, we also, you know, have a version of ours, but yours is what's at the forefront right now, and And basically, we want to help people to understand what the AfroSports Summit is and why it's important for them to get up from wherever they are in Africa and in the world, because this is not just about, the focus is Africa, right? But you have partners across the world, in Asia, in America, in Europe, in Australia, in places like that. So the message is not just about Africa. It's about sports, right? But the key stakeholders, the key players that are in the sports space. You mentioned the entities that are not necessarily directly sports related, but they contribute to the value chain in sports. And it's good for folks to understand this and how all these dynamics that play a role in terms of moving the sports sector forward, especially burgeoning and developing sports industry that is the one that's in Africa, right?
Absolutely, absolutely. That is really the way to go now. And, you know, that part of what I mentioned, that is really key for us to really increase the value of the people that really play in these conversations. And we, over the years, we have seen that a lot of the times, we really seem to limit these sort of conversations and conferences to the people who are directly sports people. But trust me, sports is, there is more to sports, and sports goes beyond just sports. And how successful sports is today, not just in Africa, a lot of it is also down to other people who are not within sports, but within the value chain and the contributions they make to sports. So it's really good to have a very inclusive event. That is key. Have an event that is really inclusive of all the major contributors of sports. Have all these people come together so that when we are making these decisions, when we are thinking about what way to go, when we are trying to solve a problem, we have input from almost very solid representations around the scope of the people that connect or engage with sports, and not just a group of people. And it's interestingly, in Ghana, for instance, we have this popular term in, or this phenomenon where we say football people. It's a very popular thing that we see. Football people essentially referring to the leaders of football in the country, for instance. And one of the issues that has come with, about this with football people is that it is believed, or some people say, that football people essentially try to run football for the rest of the country. But football is not just for football people. And so when you are making decisions, you essentially have to consider the other people within the sports value chain, some of which, without them, your work as football people would be perhaps a bit more difficult than it should be. These guys are contributing so much in terms of sponsorships, in terms of contributions, you know, to in terms of patronage or even just engaging or following the sports. And that is quite a very interesting phenomenon playing out in Ghana at the moment. So for us, having that inclusive event where we don't just limit it to just sports people, but people within the sports value chain, I think that that is one solid thing that really distinguishes the AfroSports Summit from a lot of the other events that are more focused on just people directly in sports, or the sports industry really goes beyond just people directly involved in it.
Gotcha. Definitely a must attend event. So now you have the next edition, second edition, which will be in August, I believe, this year. Can you tell the audience about this next edition, the dates and the location and all the good stuff?
Right. So this year's event obviously is going to be bigger and better than last year's event, which was the inaugural event last year. Last year we had about 250 attendees, and this year we are looking at 500 plus attendees. Last year we had about 19 speakers. This year we are looking at about 50 plus speakers. Last year we had about 9 sessions. This year we have 15 plus sessions. So it tells you about how the event has grown just in a matter of 1 year or less. And the event this year is slated for the 2nd and the 3rd of August in Ghana's capital, Accra, precisely at the Accra International Conference Center. That was where the event was held last year, and this year the event returns to the number one event center in Ghana, and hopefully with all these big numbers of attendees, bigger number of speakers, bigger number of sessions, bigger levels of participation, we hope that this year we'll be able to even achieve their ambition, even more of really connecting people, of really fostering discussions and conversations, of really putting the spotlight on some of the exciting things happening in sports in Africa, but also not some of the not so exciting things happening in Africa, and also helping people really expand their knowledge of the African space. One important thing that we also tried to do on this year's event, which we didn't have last year, is to have some workshops going on at the event, so that when people come for the African sports, for the AfroSports Summit, it's not just an event of coming to see loads of things and just come to hear loads of things just by way of hearing or information, but also leaving their feeling that they have picked up really critical skills in terms of expertise and in terms of ability to do certain things. And that is one key thing that we are looking at adding to this year's event to make it more impactful, just beyond an event where people just come to see, people just come to hear, but also they get to see their skills and expertise generally really move forward. So it's going to be bigger, it's going to be exciting. Last year, we had the likes of the Spanish La Liga, we had Start to Perform Opta, we had Sport Performance, we had the Johan Cruyff Institute for Sports, all partnering and collaborating with us to make last year's event. And this year, we've even got an even bigger level of partners, which we'll be announcing in the coming days and weeks. In terms of speakers, 50-plus speakers, we've already announced the first round of speakers. And I'm actually humbled that we have yourself, Leslie, as part of our speakers, coming to AfroSports on the 2nd and the 3rd of August to basically help foster the whole point of sports development in Africa. So it's really an event that we ourselves can't wait to share with the rest of the world. We are really keen on expanding the experience value of the event, that when people come for this event and they leave, they will have loads of nice things to say about the event in terms of in the organization, in terms of logistics, in terms of the content, in terms of speakers, in terms of the panel, in terms of topics, you know, in terms of transitions, in terms of decorations, in terms of every single thing that would increase the value of the event, and also importantly the kind of people that attend the event, the richness of people that attend the event, such that when people leave, they feel like they have actually connected with a greater number of people, expanded their networks. And already, interestingly, there are some very interesting case studies coming up from that AfroSports Summit, some which I'm not in position to share at the moment, but I do know that there is one major partnership deal which will possibly be announced because it involves one of the competitions and one of the brands that was present at AfroSport last year. And this discussion actually really, in terms of the key facilitators to make this happen, it all started at AfroSport Summit, where a brand met somebody at AfroSport Summit and they said, okay, we are trying to do this, can you help? And through that discussion, such a major partnership is about to be a big thing that will be announced very soon by the entities involved. So for us, we're already excited by the AfroSports Summit, because in terms of the relevance and importance and the case studies, we believe that we are actually already seeing some of these things manifest, and it can only serve as encouragement to us to even go ahead and do more and make the AfroSports Summit the number one sports science and business event in Africa. That's the goal, that is the ambition, and we are keen on achieving this, not just as African Sports Center, but we are keen to achieve this in collaboration or in partnership with all the other stakeholders within the sports value chain who we are trying to bring on board this AfroSport platform to develop Africa and beyond.
Wonderful, wonderful. That's like I said, it's truly amazing, and thank you again for that. Folks, well, there you have it, the AfroSports Summit Second edition will be happening in Accra, Ghana, on August 2nd and 3rd. And you're welcome to come out and be part of the experience and the event itself. And I'm fully supportive. You know, I'm with Africa Sports Ventures Group, and also here with the host of the Africa Sports Report podcast. Yes, we had a couple of editions of the Africa Sports Ventures Group, Africa Sports Business Summit and Expo, but those were online editions. We're also looking at a return of our third edition as well. That will be next year, 2024. But this is about the AfroSports Summit. This is about the AfroSports Summit with Prince Narkortu Teye, the founder of the Africa Sports and Africa Sports Center for Data Research and Technology, and the AfroSports Summit. This is huge, and this is the type of stuff we will talk about in terms of encouraging everybody in the space. Everybody will all pull together, and eventually we'll get to where we need to get to, the destination of having a robust multi-billion-dollar sports industry across the continent, where everybody realizes the value. It's not just about the money. It's about the money with meaning. It has meaning. It has direction. It has value that it brings to communities and societies and countries. So this is massive. Thank you for that.
Absolutely. And, you know, I'm actually also looking forward to your own event. I was keenly following your event last year, like I mentioned to you, when we had our last discussion. And we really need more and more of these events, you know, essentially to basically push the agenda, because like we have all said, our sports is quite lagging behind, and we really need entities like these, initiatives like these, all to come together. There's so much opportunities in African sport, but there's also so much challenges, or so many challenges in African sport, that we need all the help we can get. We need all the participants who can contribute. So initiatives like AfroSports Summit, initiatives like your own event that I'm looking forward to, the next edition next year, are the kind of things that we are looking to do. We are always looking for it, and would always encourage such similar events. And even beyond this, I know that there are some other events as well.
Mm-hmm.
And for us, we are always happy to hear of these initiatives, essentially, because the key thing is African sports development. That is the most important thing
exactly
that we want to achieve. And so anybody that contributes in this space, we are always happy, you know, to help such initiatives. And so for us at AfroSport also, we also say that AfroSport is simply a community. It's just a platform. That's all that it is, a community bringing together the stakeholders and people within the sports strategy. A community, a platform to bring all these people together. And once we find ourselves in a more organized space, like the AfroSports Summit, like these other events like yours, for instance, that it helps us to be able to have one voice. It helps us to have, you know, unity in our discussions. It helps us to really correlate the things we do, because you also would realize that one of the challenges that we have with African sports is that we seem to have the issue of silos, so many silos. We have so many people doing things within their own corners.
Mm-hmm.
And we do not have enough platforms or systems where these people get to harmonize all the things that are happening around.
Exactly.
And to me, I think that is one of the biggest problems we're having in Africa. And that also essentially means that a lot of the things we do face sustainability challenges, because an entity is solving a problem and they are not having that 360 stakeholder consultation to really engage the other people who are affected or who are involved in whatever situation it is. And so we're all trying to develop African sports, but through our own corners, and we are neglecting the power of partnerships, which is really key in sports, but not just even in sports, in the business world, out of business.
Yes.
Collaborations now are key things, you know, and so for us, the whole idea is to have this sporting community, to have this sporting platform, where every single year, annually, we would have the sports industry from within Africa, from outside of Africa, engage at that summit to essentially share ideas, to learn, to discuss, you know, showcase our good works, and basically benefit from the power of connections and collaborations and partnerships and all the other positives that such an event stands to give.
Yeah, that's a huge point that you raise in terms of the way, you know, many people operate in this space, where you know, people find their own little corners and spaces, and then operate in isolation, or as if, you know, us being in the same space as competition. Yeah, it's like when you compete. I was a former track athlete. It doesn't mean that because I'm competing with my partner over there, I can't talk to him, or we can't be friends, or we can't hang out. You know, one of my closest rival in the day when I used to compete, it's one of my best friends. We when we pick up the phone nowadays, we'll talk for hours. So it's like one of those things where, you know, you feel like we're doing something to move a space forward, and it's only when we do it in a collective and we do it as you can act in your own space and push within your own realm when your time comes. But when it comes for us to look at how we can collaborate and help each other, I think it's only prudent for us to make this possible. You know, for example, like what we're doing right now, you know, this is about projecting what the AfroSports Summit is going to be and who you are, so people who may not necessarily know you, that are within my circle, a circle of people, or people that listen to my podcast, will get an idea about who Prince Narkortu Teye is and what the AfroSports Summit is about. This is about promoting and putting the AfroSports Summit in a pedestal that it needs to be in, because it's a premier event. It's an event that brings key sports stakeholders, people in the science and business sector together, and for us to move the sports sector forward, as we say, you know. So I think the more we move forward and start to understand that it's important for us to find areas of synergy and areas of cooperation and help to push each other's narrative forward, I think once we get to that point, I think we'll still start to see massive results in terms of the growth of the sports sector across Africa. I say the sports sector because, again, we'll talk about the sports sector in terms of, in isolation, because nowadays when you look at the sports sector, it's deeply tied into the world of entertainment. You look at the music world and all of that stuff is deeply tied into all of that. So I think we're going to get to a point where eventually we'll understand the space that we're in, that it's not just something in isolation, but pushing it in isolation because it deserves that attention right now to be pushed at that at the level that we're pushing for right now. So anyway, but this is the way forward. This is how we move things forward. This is how we all come to Ghana on August 2nd and 3rd and hobnob and connect and talk about what's important and how we're going to move the sports sector forward. And make things happen. You know, I look forward to the event itself, and I thank you for your gesture, reaching out, and you know, and having me on board. And I look forward to definitely being in Accra, and look forward to getting to meet you in person as well, and also enjoying the event overall. You know, so and also I want to thank you, definitely thank you for taking your time out on this day to talk to me and to talk about the African Sports Center for Data Research and Technology, and then obviously for talking about the Afro Sports Summit as well. Thank you, and I know you have final words to say to the audience, and then, you know, we can wrap this up.
Right. So in terms of final words, there is a very important thing also to say in terms of why people should also come for the Afro Sports Summit. And when you were just speaking, you mentioned, you know, the entertainment, all these other things. Ghana, at the moment, has become a huge tourism hub or tourism center in Africa, doing very well, especially since the year of returning, 2019, I think. Every single time in December, in the summer, generally across the whole year round, there are so many people coming to Ghana just to visit Ghana, just to see Ghana, just to experience Ghana. Even we now are saying, we're Ghana, you know, basically encouraging a lot more people to basically patronize our textiles and our wearables and our clothes and all these sort of things. So for anybody out there, when you come to AfroSports Summit, it's not just for the value of sports, but also the fact that you are coming to one of the most trending tourism destinations not just in the Africa, but really in the world. And so when you are thinking about why you should come to Ghana, you should also factor in the fact that, or factor in the point that you have the chance to not just come for a sports business event, or just a science event, or a business event, or a sports event, but also the tourism side of visiting Ghana is huge. And Ghana, we are encouraging the whole world to come to Ghana, come and see Ghana, see what is going on there. We are encouraging investors to come into Ghana, which is really important for me, or important for me, why we are trying to get all these stakeholders and these brands, especially international brands, who will be part of AfroSports, to come and see Ghana, come and be in Ghana, come and see what is happening, see whether they could actually have chances of actually collaborating or starting several things in Ghana. So there's a huge tourism part of this year's event of AfroSports. And so if you want a reason to come to Ghana, know that when you come to Ghana, you are not just coming to experience a sports event or a science event or a business event, but there's that tourism part that I'm sure that a lot of people are even coming to Ghana anyways in the summer just for the tourism part. A lot of people are coming to Ghana anyways in the summer for AfroSports. So imagine actually killing two birds with one stone, coming for this conference and benefiting from all these directs, but also the chance to feel Ghana, see Ghana, experience Ghana, wear Ghana, eat Ghana, and explore Ghana. This is an opportunity that you'd want to take, and I'm looking forward to having you, Leslie, personally, in Accra,
yes,
on August 2 and 3, and also the rest of the world, welcoming every single person for AfroSport this year. So thank you so much for having me.
Yep.
It's been a pleasure talking to you and shedding light on the African Sports Center for Data Research and Technology.
You're very welcome. You're very welcome. You're very welcome.
Like I give me love, oh. Now you the catch in my shot, oh. For your sake, I go touch, oh. Yeah. We go drive around before my Porsche, oh. Baby, pana, they say you like you are like, I get you all like. Baby, pana, anywhere that you go, I go follow you the go. Baby, pana, I say you like cassava, I get to be cassava. Hey baby, pana, my love for you, you never die, you never die. Eva, Eva, oh baby, Eva, Eva. Baby, you too sweet, Eva, Java. My baby dance to the lagwaja. Make I take you to Babalada. Eva, Eva, oh baby, Eva, Eva. Baby, you too sweet, Eva, Java. My baby dance to the lagwaja. Make I take you to Babalada. So love is a beautiful thing. Yeah, you dey cool my temper. Love is a wonderful, tender feeling. You dey give me ginger. So baby, dance, dance, dance. The beauty in your eyes, they give me life, oh, oh. I could give the love the thanks, oh. For the sake, oh, yeah, for the sake of love, oh. Hey, baby, leave it up, I 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 show you love that you never seen before. For like you give me love, oh. Now you the catch in my shot, oh. For your sake, I go touch, oh. Yeah. We go drive around before my Porsche, oh. Baby, pana, they say you like you all like. I get you all like. Baby, pana, anywhere that you go, I go follow you the go. Baby, pana, they say you like cassava, I get to be cassava. Baby, pana, my love for you, we never die, we never die. Eva, Eva, oh baby, Eva, Eva. Baby, you too sweet, Eva, Java. My baby dance to the lagwaja. Make I take you to Babalada. Eva, Eva, oh baby, Eva, Eva. Baby, you too sweet, Eva, Java. My baby dance to the lagwaja. Make I take you to Babalada. I want your time, want your time. You see, you are taking my love, oh. I cannot understand how I'm feeling. You are my woman crush, oh. Wanyama, wanyama. You see, in a magabisi, oh. always be your lover. For your sake, I go to the show. Yeah, show you love that you never seen before. For like you give me love, oh. Now you the catch my shot, oh. For your sake, I go go church, oh. Yeah, we go drive around before my Porsche. Baby, pana, they say you like you are. Baby, pana, anyway that you go, follow you to go. Baby, pana, I say you like cassava, I get to be cassava. Baby, pana, Afamobu, Allah, Haji, take you low.
It's crispy, the drama guy.
You just at you, say at you.
Let me tell them how the thing goes. How the thing goes. Okay. Chebe make a tamuwa. Say my cookie now go drink God. You want to bamba. You want to tea with the big boys. Now you the run, get the kitty, you the run. Get the cat a coffee drink with a chop cup. Hey. Take a seat, how the thing goes. How the thing goes. Oh, you're telling me who bend you. Drop. Hey, that means you see me.